From Kansas State University, this is Agriculture Today. Eric Atkinson with you. Coming up today during his weekly segment, K-State's Dan O'Brien will talk about the absence of carry in the soybean market and the continuing strength in local grain sorghum prices. He'll urge you row crop producers once again to seriously evaluate the new crop pricing opportunities before you now. Then K-State's Peter Tomlinson will discuss his recent study of the carbon intensity of grain sorghum production. Peter says what he's found out will better position sorghum as a feedstock for ethanol production. He'll explain. And later, K-State's Mary Knapp lets us know just what to expect of those rainfall chances in Kansas this weekend, as she'll talk Kansas agricultural weather with us. All that here on Agriculture Today.
Make hand washing a healthy habit everywhere you go. Wash your hands with soap and water for at least 20 seconds, especially after going to the bathroom, before, during, and after preparing food, and before eating. If soap and water aren't available, use a hand sanitizer that has at least 60% alcohol. Life is better with clean hands. A message from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
This is the K-State Radio Network and Agriculture Today. First for you, the weekly look at the grain market trends. Dan O'Brien along with us from his office in Colby, Northwest Kansas. Dan is a grain market economist with K-State Research and Extension, along with us every Friday right here. What to begin with, Dan, let's talk about the carry levels in these markets, or the lack thereof. We touched upon this last week, and that continues in this week's trade, you say.
Well, yes, when you look at the soybean market with the January 21, that being the lead contract now, that November's off the board, closed yesterday at 1177.5, and every price thereafter going to March, May, July, August, all the way through January 2022, every one of them is showing no carry. So it's certainly a front-loaded market driven by exports. And last week we had exports of 118 million bushels for the week ending November 5th. This week we've dropped a little bit lower down to 94 million bushels, but that's still way over the pace of, you know, either 33, 34 per week for a 52-week year, or for a half a year, even 66. We're really outpacing what we would otherwise wonder about. And again, some back and forth dryness, a little bit of rain, back and forth, whatever, in South America. Part of that, Chinese demand coming into that market as they try to hold their food supplies together, apparently. So you see a market that's not showing, doesn't seem to be showing a trend towards slowing down yet. So holding up pretty strong. You see the soybean futures price, in essence, since lows back in May at about 8:30 or so, and then kind of a trend upward to about 8:75 in August, we've been at more than a 45-degree angle upwards through the end of October, and then got even more steep from the end of October to where we're at now. So again, closed yesterday 1177.5, touching on $12. So it's always easy to predict a trend. It's difficult to predict when a trend would change. So what would make that change? Well, if this was more of a discretionary issue and there were other places in the world that had soybeans to sell, then there'd be arbitrage back and forth pressures. But, you know, for China in particular, as they go buying, and other buyers in the world that are looking at this, but with at least a moderate delay in supplies coming out of South America, the actual beans may not show up till the end of February next year, but the anticipation of them would come in probably, if the crops are looking good, somewhere in February. So a big issue for corn. The corn price yesterday for the DEES contract, lead contract there, still the lead, closed at 422.5, down about 3 cents. Hasn't really been showing a lot of weakening, a similar but not quite as dynamic sharp trend higher as for soybeans. Again, the low we're looking at is back in the first part of August at about 320. Well, here we're a dollar or two higher than that. Jumped up to on the high of trade just under 430. Again, what's interesting on the corn side is that we're seeing the actual pace of exports being just so-so, about 33 million bushels, need about 56 to hit the USDA's actual shipment projections for the rest of this marketing year. We're 11 weeks in, but the purchases ahead have gotten up to about 52% of the USDA's raised projection. So you're seeing some support there, really anticipation of shipments to come. Mm-hmm. This is where, and in particular, the desire of China to increase their hog herd, again, to keep that expansion going, their own crop production problems that happened this summer really coming in. And China is a big player in our corn export market. You and I talked before the broadcast about the strength of this past week in grain sorghum. Yeah. They had a 10 million bushel actual shipment week in grain sorghum. We were at, 2.3, 3.2, something like that. We jumped. So we kind of aggregated everything together in 1 week and then sent it. And will that keep going? I don't know. But the pre-sales haven't slowed down. In fact, they've accelerated for grain sorghum. We're up to basically 60% pre-bought, either shipped or pre-bought, of the USDA's projection of 260 million bushels. And we're only 20-some percent of the way into that marketing year. And you see it in the bids across Kansas. Look at the Garden City Co-op, where you could feed wheat in that area, you could feed sorghum, you could do whatever, because you got so much all right there in that area, livestock feeding ethanol and you name it. The actual cash bid for grain sorghum in Garden City yesterday was $5.53, cash bid for corn, $4.48. So, and they're both basis off that December contract. So strong basis levels, and you must not be seeing any hesitancy about what the future holds for sorghum export shipments. So I'm an economist. They pay me to wring my hands and worry, So what we've talked about for soybeans, for corn, for grain sorghum, such a strong influence from China in those markets at this time. So we have a very strong but very narrow demand base, especially for beans and especially for grain sorghum. So there's a systematic geopolitical risk of what could happen over in that part of the world. And we hear about confrontations over sea lanes and territories and such, the issue of the U.S. and Taiwan in the news here of late. So I'm not trying to make people be as pessimistic and worried as an over-worried economist like me. But the point is that we have some pricing opportunities, even new crop ones, to consider. And given not so much the ag factors as they stand, but the geopolitical factors that are out there that could shake the commodity markets temporarily, cause a lot of whipsawing. Well, it shaked first the financial markets and the stock market, worries about the U.S. economy. And then when that happens, it comes to the commodities. I think that's something to think about. Again, we don't anticipate any problems, but it's on the ag side, it's full bore. But you have other things, these other financial market, political, geopolitical things in line that I guess I just encourage people to be thoughtful about not missing out on some of the opportunities we have now just because of the uncertainty and the volatility of the world situation.
Because it is the head turner in the markets this week, grain sorghum, Dan, just a bit more on that. We see, of course, these premiums to corn right now. At what point do we see this actually start figuring into the bidding for acres for spring planting?
Well, I don't know exactly, but I do know the one question that I've gotten in meetings and in emails, et cetera, is it comes from analysts and some farmers and some people in the grain industry wondering what will happen to acreage. When you look at the main areas of the state that where we grow grain sorghum, we don't grow much of it in the eastern third. Some, for sure, but not a lot. Northwest grows some, but the largest places in the state of Kansas where we grow grain sorghum has been southwest Kansas, 718,000 acres planted this last year, got up to about 820,000 acres in 2016. And then you have west central, a place where they need a drought-tolerant crop, feed grain. 471,000 acres last year, had gotten up at one time as high as 566. And then you look at North Central, North Central dropped down to about 276 or so last year, but they had been as high as 550. So if we do expand grain sorghum and you see where we've grown it, you'd wonder if anything, if say North Central Kansas, since we've grown that before, if that's where we would go. I'm saying if that's where we would go. Central Kansas, pretty consistent, had been 530,000 back in 2015, about 460 so, 440 so. So there's some potential to expand there. And probably South Central, again, we had been 474,000 acres in 2015, dropped to about 300 and some. So you've got some places in the state of Kansas, if farmers are going to consider doing this, you know, where they've grown it before. Now, we talk about that. We also have corn growers listening, and we have soybean producers, and we have wheat acres. So we're not cheering for any one of these. You know, we have to be an impartial judge in all this stuff. But that price differential is a big thing. And again, I would just say, you do not know what could happen to undo some of the pricing opportunities we have now. So I'd at least be watchful.
And because this ties in, as does grain sorghum, to our next topic here on the broadcast, a quick update, if you would, on what's happening with the ethanol production scene, whether it's maintaining the rebound that we'd seen after the doldrums of earlier in the year.
Well, I think the whole energy complex is probably at risk to what could happen to the U.S. economy if we go into another major lockdown. And if fuel demand gets hurt, that was the cause of the problems in ethanol that happened in March, April, May. But we've recovered from that. We're about 87-88% of the way back to where we were before. Actually, one thing that's been helping the ethanol market is that stocks have been dwindling. So we're producing a fair amount of ethanol, but it's getting gobbled up as we blended it with RBOB gasoline. So right now, the ethanol market is looking pretty good as things go. But if the U.S. economy goes into a major lockdown, we start to get to where we're not driving again, and we cut back fuel consumption, that no doubt will be a hard direct hit at ethanol and a hard direct hit at corn. So we need to be thoughtful of that.
We appreciate those observations, as always, Dan. And in advance, have a good Thanksgiving holiday. We'll catch up again soon.
Thank you very much, Eric.
Dan O'Brien is a grain market economist, K-State Research and Extension. We will return in a moment on Agriculture Today.
A social distancing tip.
Putting distance between yourself and others is critical to slowing the spread of coronavirus. So here are ways to stay in contact without the physical contact part. Call, send a text, set up a video conference, post on social media, dedicate a song on the radio. If you have symptoms of fever, dry cough, and shortness of breath, call your healthcare provider before going to their office. For more info, visit coronavirus.gov.
Let's all do our part, because we're all hashtag alone together. Brought to you by the Ad Council.
We're back now on Agriculture Today. Grain sorghum production here in Kansas, of course, is highly prominent, one of the favored row crops in the state. There's new research out of Kansas State University which puts a check mark beside grain sorghum as a feedstock for ethanol production, and it has to do with its environmental activity, to put it that way. We'll explain. Peter Tomlinson is with us. He's an environmental quality specialist in K-State's Department of Agronomy and one of those who's been conducting this study, Peter, of the carbon intensity of grain sorghum. Now, what is that exactly?
Yes, and what that means is feedstocks that are going into ethanol production all have a certain carbon intensity value, and that value or that carbon intensity number is derived from all of the inputs that go into the production, as well as any carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, or methane that is emitted during the production cycle. And so that is all aggregated together to arrive at a carbon intensity value for that grain that's produced as it enters into the ethanol production stream. And why this is important for our producers and why the grain sorghum industry is interested is, you know, one, it's important for ethanol produced here in Kansas to stay competitive, particularly in the California market area, where they look at the carbon intensity scores, but they also, you know, there's increasing interest in the ability to market grain-based ethanol under the low carbon fuel standard, which really requires us to be able to document what our carbon footprint is during the production. And as we looked at the literature about 3 years ago, there hadn't been any work done in Western Kansas. And so the grain sorghum industry had approached me. I had some work going here in the Manhattan area, and there was interest in developing a project that would look at the grain sorghum belt really from the northern edge in roughly the Colby area down through the panhandle of Oklahoma. And so I had been working with a colleague at Oklahoma State, Jason Warren, who is in their agronomy department, and then partnered with Lucas Haig, our Northwest area agronomist originally, and then after a year of preliminary data, Alan Schlegel came on board. And so now we have three study sites, one at Colby, one at Tribune, and then one in Goodwill, Oklahoma. And so we're able to look across that sorghum belt, and we've got a number of fertility rates in our research. And so what we're really working to document is what is the nitrous oxide emission.
And that's the benchmark you're using for carbon intensity, so to speak?
Yeah, so nitrous oxide is, when we think about the fertilizer aspect of the production, when the nitrogen fertilizer is applied, it's the area that we've got the least research information on. And so in the absence of information, they're defaulting to some default values that come out of the IPCC or Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report that sets an emissions factor of approximately 1% of the nitrogen fertilizer applied. Going into this, we hypothesized that given the dry environment of Western Kansas, that in fact, the emissions factor from the nitrogen fertilizer going on grain sorghum would be less than that 1%. And in fact, we have found that. We're about 0.5%. And so when that gets factored into calculating the carbon intensity score, that nitrous oxide emissions factor is multiplied by 298, which puts it on a CO2 equivalent. A small reduction of 0.5% really amplifies quickly. And so by being able to document this, we feel pretty comfortable at this point that we're going to be able to show some real value in grain sorghum from Western Kansas going into the ethanol stream. And my hope would be that eventually, you know, our grain sorghum producers may even see some credit coming back from the ethanol industry for a low carbon intensity score grain. You know, we're working on some additional proposals for projects to expand this work to look at corn produced in Western Kansas, and we'll see where that work goes.
This is so thorough that you even broke it down, looking at these nitrous oxide emissions during the production season as well as during the fallow period.
Yes. So there's components of both the direct nitrogen application as well as the nitrogen that is released back into the system as that residue decomposes during the fallow period. And this is really one of the challenges with our wheat fallow, grain sorghum fallow system, where we've got these large windows of time where we're not growing a crop, because the calculation window would run from the time that grain sorghum is harvested in October or November all the way through that next summer until winter wheat is planted. Whereas if you stack that up against corn coming out of, you know, the Midwest, you are only going to have October, November, until soybeans likely are planted in April or May. Very short window versus a long window. So if we are multiplying that period of time by a default value that doesn't represent what our emissions actually are during that period of time, it can greatly overestimate what's being lost. And so that's why it's been critical to do the research and develop this information.
And presuming here that you conducted these field trials in reduced tillage conditions with previous crop residue existing, does that figure in here at all, Peter?
It does. So we've had the opportunity. We've had the location at Tribune is a strictly no-till. The location at Colby has tillage ahead of wheat, but then the grain sorghum has been no-tilled into the wheat residue. So we've got a mix between our two locations in Kansas, trying to capture some of that variability in what we see across the landscape. And so at both the Tribune and the Colby location, we've got a small plot replicated study there where we're looking at a range of nitrogen fertilizer rates. Part of this is in the long run, we'll be able to add to our knowledge about sorghum nitrogen fertility needs and, you know, add that to the data set to improve our nitrogen recommendations for grain sorghum. But it also, that range allows us to gain a better understanding of those nitrous oxide emissions and really what the nitrogen efficiency is of our cropping systems.
Very good. This work done largely in the western part of the state, are there applications here as we think about grain sorghum productivity further east in the wetter climate? Or is that something you'd like to explore further?
So, you know, it's an interesting question. Actually, my first adventure in doing nitrous oxide measurements when I started here at K-State was here in the Manhattan area at our long-term cover crop site south of town. And that was set up as a wheat cover crop grain sorghum soybean rotation. And so we have about 6 years of data off of that study. And that's really what piqued the interest of the grain sorghum industry was that work and the fact that even here in the wetter side of the state, we were showing some improvements in the efficiency of grain sorghum compared to the default values that were being used. So we have that information available now.
So this has been a deep dive into the carbon footprint of grain sorghum. This is a pretty big deal, although it's steeped in the science. This could make a great lot of difference in grain sorghum's competitive abilities in the ethanol market, you think?
It's very key to grain sorghum staying competitive in the ethanol market because the scientific data is needed, needs to be published, needs to be available. So when folks that are developing the models and developing the equations that ultimately lead to a carbon intensity score for a given grain, they look to the scientific literature and pull the values that are coming out of that. And if there are no values, then they look to these default values. So, you know, this is critical work to support our grain sorghum industry and our growers in Kansas.
Great project. Peter, thanks for reporting on this to us today.
Glad to be here today and look for more work to be coming in the future. We just here recently started a large project with the Department of Energy that will be looking also at nitrous oxide emissions and the carbon intensity score for grain sorghum at a larger scale with a higher frequency of data measurements. So there'll be more information coming in the near future.
Looking forward to hearing about it. Peter Tomlinson, he's an environmental quality specialist, K-State's Department of Agronomy, right there telling us about the carbon intensity study regarding grain sorghum production that he and others have been carrying out in the western part of the state of late with quite influential, potentially, results. We'll have more on agriculture today here on the K-State Radio Network.
Have you ever thought about where your food comes from? If you're thinking the grocery store, think again. Facts show that the American farmer feeds more than 129 people.
They are continually increasing and improving their operations. A wide variety of crops and livestock are grown in Kansas as well as the United States, providing food to your dinner plate.
Next time you see a farmer or rancher, thank them. For more information, contact K-State Research and Extension.
From the campus of Kansas State University, this is Agriculture Today, and welcome back. Eric Atkinson here with today's agricultural news headlines for you now, these courtesy in part of DTN. Tyson Foods suspended top officials at its largest pork plant yesterday and launched an investigation into allegations that they were wagering on how many workers would get infected during the widespread coronavirus outbreak. The company's president and CEO, Dean Banks, said he was extremely upset about the allegations against the managers at its plant in Waterloo, Iowa, saying that they do not represent the company's values. He said that the company has retained a law firm to conduct an investigation. That investigation will be led by former U.S. Attorney General Eric Holder. Now, quoting Banks, if these claims are confirmed, we'll take all measures necessary to root out and remove this disturbing behavior from our company, again in Banks' words. He said the accused had been suspended without pay, but did not elaborate. Tyson faced backlash over recently amended wrongful COVID death lawsuits in which plaintiff's lawyers alleged that the Waterloo plant manager, Tom Hart, and quoting the lawsuit here, organized a cash buy-in, winner-take-all betting pool for supervisors and managers to wager on how many employees would test positive for COVID-19. Enlist Duo's registration has survived another legal challenge after the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit declined to reevaluate part of its earlier ruling upholding the herbicide's registration. Back in July, a panel of three Ninth Circuit judges ruled in a 2-1 judgment that the herbicide, which is a premix designed to be sprayed over the top of 2,4-D-tolerant Enlist crops, did not violate federal law, as a group of environmental groups had alleged in a lawsuit. The judges did order the EPA to reevaluate Enlist Duo's impacts on monarch butterflies, but left the herbicide's registration intact and on the market. Specifically, the plaintiffs in the Enlist Duo case, led by the Natural Resources Defense Council and the Center for Food Safety, then filed a petition in late September asking for the larger panel of Ninth Circuit judges to rehear part of their lawsuit. The plaintiffs argued that the original July ruling violated the Endangered Species Act, ignored legal precedent, and created a dangerous loophole, as they put it, for future pesticide registrations. But on Wednesday, the Ninth Circuit again rejected those arguments, and as a result, the petition was rejected. The plaintiffs now only have one final recourse, an appeal to the U.S. Supreme Court. This decision comes as Corteva AgriScience, the current registrant of Enlist Duo, is gearing up to oversee the planting of a record number of its 2,4-D-tolerant Enlist crops in 2021. USDA Secretary Sonny Perdue says that farm commodity prices and farm income are reflecting the results of better U.S. trade deals. Here's more from the USDA's Gary Crawford.
Because of trade agreements like USMCA, Phase 1 with China, and agreements with Japan and other countries,
I think we have reset the trading paradigm for the future.
Agriculture Secretary Sonny Perdue telling the National Association of Farm Broadcasting virtual convention Thursday that commodity prices and farm income projections are beginning to reflect the better trade situation.
I think we've laid the platform for increased trade. I frankly, I'm not a market guru, but I think you see the prices being reflected are reflecting that this fall.
Perdue said farm income bottomed out in 2016, but has increased 33% since then. And according to the USDA projection for the 2020 crop year,
farm income will be above the 20-year average.
This is Gary Crawford reporting for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
Through the per bushel assessment on your production, you wheat producers invest in worldwide efforts to promote U.S. wheat usage abroad. But does that wheat export promotion campaign pay off? Well, the numbers say resoundingly yes, as we hear from Marcia Boswell on this week's Kansas Wheat Scoop. Marcia?
From breaking bread in Japan to making tortillas in Mexico to producing instant noodles in Nigeria, hard red winter wheat is a staple ingredient in family dinners around the world. According to Kansas Wheat VP of Research and Operations Aaron Harries, about half of the Kansas wheat crop is exported every year. Each market has unique cuisines and market demands, but each also adds value to farmers' bottom line. According to a January 2016 economic analysis of wheat export promotion, U.S. wheat farmers received $45 in net revenue for every dollar invested in export promotion from 2007 to 2014. Mexico is the largest customer year in and year out for Kansas hard red winter wheat, thanks to an interconnected supply chain between Kansas elevators and Mexican flour mills. Duty-free access established by the NAFTA agreement and solidified by the U.S.-Mexico-Canada agreement helps keep wheat flowing south, mainly by rail. Mexico has purchased 51.6 million bushels of U.S. hard red winter wheat in the 2020-2021 marketing year. Chinese purchases of hard red winter jumped from 0 to 36 million bushels as of November 5th. These purchases made following the Phase 1 agreement, which went into effect in early 2020, put China as the second largest market for hard red winter wheat thus far in this marketing year. Related to these trade policy discussions, China agreed to start filling an annual reduced tariff rate quota for imported wheat of nearly 353 million bushels. Nigeria's appetite for instant noodles has grown exponentially as U.S. wheat farmers and U.S. wheat associates helped the milling and noodle manufacturing industries develop in this West African nation. Competition for wheat sales with the Black Sea is growing in this cost-sensitive market, making it important for groups like Kansas Wheat to stay in close contact with these key customers. Nigeria remains the third largest customer for hard red winter wheat in the current marketing year, purchasing 21.3 million bushels. Japanese flour millers and U.S. wheat farmers have partnered together for more than 60 years to the mutual growth and prosperity of both. Approval of the U.S.-Japan trade agreement in 2019 helped solidify this trading relationship by putting U.S. wheat exports on equal footing with competing supplies in Canada and Australia. As the fourth largest customer thus far in the marketing year, Japan has purchased 20.8 million bushels of U.S. hard red winter wheat, up 6% year over year. Learn more about each of these markets and the incredible return on investment from export market promotion through Kansas Wheat's partner organization, U.S. Wheat Associates, at uswheat.org. For Kansas Wheat, I'm Marcia Boswell.
Thanks, Marcia. Well, rain is on the way, but just how much can we expect? Mary Knapp will tell us when she's in next, right here on Agriculture Today.
When you are in need of timely, reliable, and trusted information, K-State Research and Extension is here. Whether it's organizing people, information, or resources, they have the necessary tools. Community comes first for K-State Research and Extension. For more information and to connect with your county's extension agents, visit www.ksre.k-state.edu.
Coming your way now on Agriculture Today, Kansas agricultural weather, and our weekly get-together with Mary Knapp, climatologist, K-State Research and Extension. The feature of note this week, Mary, the continued dry weather coupled with those really blustery winds around Kansas, and that did nothing but hike the wildfire danger that already existed out there.
Right. There were quite a few red flag days across most of the state, and it wasn't just the wind and lack of precip, although that greatly added to the danger, but we also had very low humidities and warm temperatures. And they have not, although the winds have calmed a little bit, those fire dangers have not gone away. One of the big problems is that the fire behavior has been much more aggressive than might be indicated by just, say, the fuel loads or the wind speeds. That means that fires are very easily started. Some have been started from as little as a shorting electrical fence. Others have started from some sort of incident along the roadways, whether it be smoking material that's been discarded or sparks from a dragging chain, any number of things that can cause it. We've had two fires in the last week that have made it to the National Forest Service fire page, and in order to make that, you have to have over 1,000 acres involved. One was up in northwest Kansas, known as the Prairie Dog Fire, and that was over 2,000 acres. The other one was in central Kansas, the Kiowa fire near Greensburg, and that was over 5,000 acres. And that doesn't even get to the one that we saw in Shawnee County. So, again, it's an issue across the state, and we remind our listeners to be very, very cautious because it won't take much to get something started that will be very, very difficult to control.
We're not past that danger yet, although relief may be coming here soon, and we'll talk about that. Another thing we wanted to catch up on here, soil temperature levels around Kansas are now declining, and that's important to our winter wheat growers, Mary.
Right. As Romulo Lolato noted last week in his e-update about the winter wheat, when the soil temperatures drop below 50 degrees is when you start getting the active development of winter hardiness in the wheat crop. And we've dropped below that. The average weekly soil temperatures have dropped below 50 for most of this state. That's not to say that it won't warm up during the day, but those average temperatures are dropping down into the range that we can start getting that winter hardiness to develop in the wheat. We're going to see some warmer than normal temperatures continue, but that doesn't mean we're not going to have those cold temperatures to go along with it. And we can see that in this last week where our highest temperature was 78, but we had temperatures drop down into the 12-degree range as well. So, again, it's been a big roller coaster on the temperatures, and that's likely to continue throughout the winter. Note that for the week I'm talking about is the week that ends on Tuesday, which is what feeds our U.S. drought monitor.
Speaking of which, any change on that front?
Yes, we had quite a bit of expansion in the drought monitor in this last week. The moderate drought filled in across the central part of the state, crept a little bit further south in the north central. There was also expansion in the severe and extreme drought in western Kansas. There was one very tiny area of improvement in southeast Kansas where they did see some significant rain to add to the rains that ended October. And so there was a tiny area of improvement. If you go to our climate webpage under news, there is a link to weekly drought updates where you can find that latest information and the previous week's worth of information if you're interested.
Well, what about that expected rainfall this weekend? What's coming together to generate that?
Well, there is a disturbance that's setting up that it looks like it's going to go across Oklahoma into Missouri, and Kansas is going to benefit from that a little bit. It's going to be, again, our normal collision of a cold air front coming from the northwest and the warm, moist air from the south. The question is, where does that front set up? Earlier runs had it setting up right over Kansas, bringing some very nice moisture across the state. The latest ones have shifted it a little bit to the south and east. So right now, the outlook for the next week is the biggest rains are going to be in southeast Kansas, where they may see as much as 2, maybe even 3 inches of rain. As you move a little bit north and west, the amounts drop off. In the Manhattan area, we may see between 3/4 of an inch and maybe as much as an inch. Get into central Kansas, the Hays, Salina area, 1/2 inch to 3/4 of an inch. That amount may also be in the Dodge City area. You get out towards Garden City, you're going to be more in the 1/4 to 1/2 inch. And you get north and west of that, and you're looking at maybe seeing as much as 1/10 of an inch. But get in extreme northwest Kansas and Cheyenne County, they may only see the clouds and not see any moisture from it at all.
And the December outlook is out, and does it suggest anything different?
No, unfortunately, the December outlook carries the trend that we expect with a La Nina, which is for milder than normal temperatures and below normal precip. Again, we're moving into our dry season. December, January, and February are the driest months on our calendar. So being drier than normal could be very dry indeed. And that means that these fire dangers are not going to go away. We're talking for most of Kansas, one-hour fuels, they're the fine grasses, and they will dry out very, very quickly, even if we do get some rain.
Keep those precautions in your normal routine. And we'll talk in a couple of weeks, in that we'll be away for the holiday next Friday. Mary, many thanks to you.
Thanks, Eric.
Mary Knapp, climatologist, K-State Research and Extension with us. Well, to let you know here, because of a combination of the university's furlough requirement and the Thanksgiving holiday, we'll be away all next week. So we'd invite you to rejoin us on Monday, the 30th of November. In the meantime, thanks for listening in, and in advance, a happy Thanksgiving to you and yours. Eric Atkinson here. This has been Agriculture Today over the K-State Radio Network.